Okay. Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining me and my colleague, Yael Friedman, for the first steps of this research project on challenges and opportunities of showcasing Middle Eastern content. As you must know, as you've joined us, this little event this afternoon starts with a brilliant keynote by our colleague and wonderful Professor Shohini Chaudhuri, which I will do a little introduction that I'm sure won't do her wonderful justice. And then she'll give us a talk on her new book that I'll introduce in a second. And then we'll have time for questions afterwards, and we take a short break. And then at 1:30, we'll come back to have a roundtable with a number of wonderful colleagues, academics, and curators, festival organizers, and industry people to talk about these challenges and opportunities. So the way we see for this research project that we're hoping to develop with the help of everybody here today is we believe that the wonderful work by Shohini that will give us the wonderful keynote, her book, the recent book entitled Crisis Cinema in the Middle East, Creativity and Constraints in Iran and the Arab World, almost very well sets the context in which us as scholars and organizers and people who want to bring films from the region to the UK. And so we kind of felt like this is such a great opportunity to have this keynote today that kind of very beautifully sets the ground for us to then have the conversation at the roundtable. So without any further ado, I'll just give a short introduction to Professor Shohini Chaudhuri, and thank you so much for joining us today and giving your time and giving us an in-depth look to your wonderful book. Those of you who might want to know that she is a film scholar that works as well as a film activist and an educator. And her research focuses on global and world cinema, human rights, film philosophy, feminist and postcolonial theory. She's to this date has published numerous journal articles and chapters, as well as four books. So her book, Feminist Film Theory, was published in 2006. Her contemporary world cinema, Europe, the Middle East, East Asia and South Asia, was published in 2005. Followed by her brilliant work, Cinema of the Dark Side, Atrocity and Ethics of Film Spectatorship in 2014. And her recent work that she will be talking to us about, Crisis Cinema in the Middle East, Creativity and Constraints in Iran and the Arab World. I don't want to take any more time because we're all here to listen to Shohini. So please join me in welcoming her to start her talk. Thank you very much.
Hi, thank you very much, Maryam. That's a wonderful introduction. I'm very honored to be speaking here today as the keynote speaker. This book has actually been influenced by several of the speakers who will be presenting at the round table later today, including Elhom Shakarifa and Shema Bouali, who advised and supported me in the early stages. So I feel like I've come full circle with this book, which started with a series of film screenings and talks at the Mosaic Rooms that I organized, and in which I invited them to take part, and Yael Friedman also took part in that. So it's great to be here. Thank you very much, all of you, for coming. So as you can tell by the title of this talk, it's based on my book. It's a new book that's actually out officially in hardback from Bloomsbury next week, Crisis Cinema in the Middle East, Creativity and Constraint in Iran and the Arab World. It's a study of freedom of expression, looking at the dynamic between creativity and constraint in independent filmmaking from the region. Now, cinematic freedom of expression is typically understood through the lens of state censorship. But in the book, I explore the numerous obstacles facing filmmakers, how their choices are shaped by these constraints, and how they transform those constraints into creative opportunities. The research is partly based on interviews with both new and established filmmakers from the region. My aim was to help readers understand the multiple constraints of production and distribution in the region by learning from filmmakers' firsthand experiences. In this talk, I'll introduce you to some of the ways in which I tackle these issues in the book, putting an emphasis on distribution in the UK, since that's the emphasis, that's the framing of this event, but the scope of the book is actually wider than this. And then I'll discuss the documentary For Sama, co-directed by Wad Al-Khatib and Edward Watts, to unpack some of these issues further through this example. Now, one of the constraints immediately confronting any filmmaker from the region, especially those seeking to present their work in the West, is the perception of the Middle East as a crisis hotspot. As Nat Muller writes, the generic image of the Middle East, known to the West from bad news, is full of stories of conflict, failed states, fundamentalism, terrorism, and violence. The term Middle East itself, along with labels such as MENA and the Arab world, can give the impression that the region is a monolith, an orientalist way of thinking that belies its complexity and diversity. And perhaps later on, we'll talk about the terms which are helpful or unhelpful for describing the region. Nonetheless, I mean, I'm just taking this word crisis to begin with and sort of unpacking it a little bit. Nonetheless, during my book's 2009 to 20 timeframe, the region has been rocked by multiple crises, starting with the disputed 2009 presidential election in Iran that led to the Green Movement protests and acted as a precursor to the uprisings across the region that have often been followed by brutal state crackdowns. Crisis can also be an accurate description of one's lived experience and diagnosis of present conditions. Independent filmmakers often undercut standard ways of thinking about crisis by making visible what's often invisible in both official state and international media depictions. So you have the international media that tend to present this view from above, that of international players and the regime, whereas independent filmmakers in the region often present the view from below, that of ordinary people's lives. In this way, they explore the fault lines of generic crisis images and offer something more specific. The films produced in this period arise from a state of crisis, registering the pressures under which they were made. They are crisis images related to, yet distinct from, previous eras. For my notion of the crisis image, I draw on the philosopher and film theorist Gilles Deleuze, who characterizes the breakdown of the action image and transition to the time image as a crisis within cinema related to the crisis of the Second World War. If the time image was a way of a new way of thinking about crisis for post-war European cinema, the creative strategies explored in my book are Middle Eastern filmmakers' techniques for understanding their contemporary realities. I'm just going to share my screen so I can show you my PowerPoint. Okay. So hopefully you can see this.
Yes, that's perfect. Yeah.
Okay. Now, Middle Eastern cinema is also typically framed by state censorship, so much so that many filmmakers are tired of being constantly asked about it at international film festival Q&As. As the Iranian filmmaker Mani Haghighi attests, the Western audience's exclusive focus on censorship in Iran has been a source of constant annoyance for me over the years. I find it, above all, to be a passive-aggressive strategy of self-congratulation. Ah, poor you, we are so much freer than you. Despite the fact that the Middle East is known as the world's worst region for free expression, filmmakers have found creative ways of telling their stories that attest to their imagination, courage, and resilience. their work points to more nuanced perspectives than either standard news images of crisis or black and white ideas of what's permissible or not. So in my book, I reframe the problem of freedom of expression. Constraints rather than censorship is my preferred term for limitations to free expression. It has the advantage of highlighting the variety of obstacles facing filmmakers and shifts debates beyond state censorship, which is only one form of control and by no means the only challenge that filmmakers face. In film terms, a constraint can be defined as a limitation of choices or an obstacle in the process of producing, distributing, or exhibiting a movie. Here, I'm building on the work of the philosopher John Elster, who has distinguished between pre-existing constraints, such as technological, economic, institutional, and societal factors, and self-imposed constraints chosen or invented by the artist, such as decisions of style or genre. My own typology of constraints expands and modifies Elster's in a way that applies to independent filmmakers from Iran and the Arab world. They include political, infrastructural, economic, technological, and social and religious constraints, security risks and ethical constraints, travel restrictions, temporal, environmental, and linguistic constraints, formal constraints, and self-imposed constraints. And I'll speak briefly about some of these as they relate to distribution. Among the infrastructural constraints, shortage of screens in the region is a persistent problem, despite the growth of film festivals and distributors there, and also the rise of streaming. And I know there's a great book coming out shortly, which is Cinema in the Arab World, which will focus on distribution exclusively. So I think that that book's going to be a real important contribution to these areas. Due to these and other difficulties, independent filmmakers often rely on foreign funders, co-producers, distributors, film festivals, and television networks. Their films are often screened abroad, but not in the countries where their stories are set or where they are from. This brings some freedom from local constraints, including state censorship, but at the same time, external funders and markets impose other rules and expectations. In written and unwritten selection criteria for funding applications, development labs, festivals, and television sales and commissions, filmmakers' work is expected to comply with a challenging list of requirements to be urgent or timely, implying that it has cultural value only for that moment, to be universal rather than merely local, and to be authentic to the filmmaker's country of origin. Filmmakers often find themselves burdened with the task of explaining their part of the world. And this was Naziha Aribi's experience with Freedom Fields. And you see her here on this slide talking to Yael Friedman. This was one of the events that I organized, and Yael was the chair of this panel talking to filmmakers, including Naziha Aribi. Since there had been few previous films about or from Libya, her documentary carried a huge burden of expectation that it should be explanatory and comprehensive. But with the help of her producers, Aribi managed to keep those pressures at bay, and she says, let the film be what it's truly about, which she felt was both a blessing and a curse, but it made the production more financially difficult. At the same time as being expected to be explanatory of a place, stories are often expected to fit pre-existing narratives of exoticism, oppressed Muslim women, and Islamic terrorism. These criteria hold Middle Eastern films to standards to which Western films are not usually held, reflecting gatekeepers' preferences and fashions for subjects they want to hear about, and Orientalist stereotypes inherited from other films and news media. Film scholars often criticize the adoption of particular filmmaking formulas in order to target festivals and be commercially viable for international markets, but they tend to be less sensitive to how filmmakers experience these stereotypical expectations of the region from funders and festivals as a constraint on their free speech, which is just as harmful as state censorship. As a Lebanese director, Philippe Eric Tingi, says, "I'm a filmmaker from the Middle East. Am I allowed to make a normal film? You know, it's not allowed, because the Europeans who read your work don't see you like that. They see you as third world. We're put in one niche, which is drama, where women are beaten." So he was very vexed on this issue. Filmmakers also feel expected to endanger themselves, since films deemed risk-taking are appealing to international festivals and TV channels. Their dependency on European grants and markets, furthermore, divorces them from audiences at home. Elster uses the term formal constraints to refer to an audience, to refer to an artist's anticipation of audience expectations and how this formally shapes a work. He classifies them, along with material, technical, or financial restrictions, as hard constraints, as opposed to soft constraints such as genre conventions. Hard constraints come from external sources. However, that is not to say that they are fixed and unchanging. Maybe one day, filmmakers will no longer encounter Orientalist stereotyping as audiences, funders, festivals, and broadcasters change their habits of thought and practices. Formal constraints include classical Hollywood narrative, which favors clear, coherent storytelling in three or five acts with believable characters, a globally dominant form. Many films from the region abide by these constraints, although they also challenge them or deploy them towards other ends and experimental practices. Length is another constraint. Running times have historically been determined by commercial reasons, such as exhibitors or broadcasters' programming schedules, resulting in the standard 90-minute theatrical feature or 48 and a half minutes for a television documentary, the latter allowing for advert breaks. In television documentary particularly, you're literally counting every second that you've got, as Sarah Afshar told me when I interviewed her about her documentary, Series Disappeared, which was made for Channel 4. So obviously this entails ruthless compromises for anything that doesn't fit clear storytelling. In the main body of the book, I present nine chapters, each of them dealing with a particular creative solution or strategy that filmmakers apply to these constraints. And each chapter is illustrated by several case study films. Now, these nine creative strategies are not meant to be exhaustive, but rather indicative of the many creative possibilities that exist. It was really important to me to have approaches or strategies as the titles of the chapters, rather than organizing the book thematically so as not to pigeonhole the filmmakers into representational strategies or categories that might essentialize their work. The documentary For Summer is an example of witnessing. So that's the strategy that I'm going to focus on for the rest of this talk. For Summer is made from conflict footage made in, it's filmed in Syria by Wad al-Khatib, a Syrian filmmaker identifying as a citizen journalist. She'd been sending her footage of the siege in the Syrian city of Aleppo to the UK's Channel 4, and it was later shaped into a cinematic narrative in For Summer through her collaboration with a British filmmaker, Edward Watts. According to Tamer Asher and Amit Penchevsky, media witnessing is a field of unevenly distributed resources and power struggles between different agents, each with their own goals and agendas. eyewitnesses strive to gain access to mediators, in this case, TV networks and other news outlets, NGOs and film festivals, in order to mobilize international solidarity and action, while mediators seek compelling images from eyewitnesses. Mediators act as gatekeepers who select, commission, edit, upload, broadcast, and archive testimonies and train and equip citizen witnesses. It's mostly they who shape a narrative from otherwise chaotic events, providing a platform for it to be witnessed by others. News and current affairs programs in particular are driven by what's new and topical, which makes it harder to pitch work that's about an ongoing issue or a past issue, that goes without saying. In these asymmetric relations, mediators wield more power, yet mediators and eyewitnesses are mutually dependent. Eyewitnesses are uniquely advantaged by having been there on location, although entering the field of witnessing and getting heard is a struggle. For their part, mediators rely on eyewitnesses to relay events on the ground. In 2019, For Sama was released into a political and media landscape, which by that time had already been saturated, in inverted commas, with images from Syria. The conflict had dropped in the news agenda, and the global public was reportedly tired of hearing about it. The filmmakers' creative choices were utterly shaped by this landscape. The film begins with its protagonist and co-director Wad Al-Khatib talking affectionately to her baby daughter Sama in their bedroom. So I'm just going to show you a clip from the beginning of the film now.
Sama, mama, mama, Asizan, so Halloween. عم بيدوروا حول سما مبسوطين شربوا مي قالوا خير ماما سما سما جيت بس ننزل بسرعة ممكن
Okay, so as you saw, there's this aerial attack, and they all make their way downstairs to the basement of the hospital where they're living, because Al-Khatib's husband, Hamza, is a doctor. Now, for Sama's first-person female account contrasts with dominant male viewpoints on conflict, especially as it's a mother's perspective. The narrative is structured as a letter from a mother to her daughter, and it draws its particular power from a mother's act of telling her child the story of her fight for freedom and justice for her country's future generations. This very personal and yet at the same time universal story is key to the film's success, as Donatella Della Ratta has noted in her reading of the film as a neo-Orientalist dynamic between a Syrian filmmaker and British co-director serving the Western market. However, my interviews with the filmmakers illuminate the constraints and opportunities of this relationship and their agency within the field of media witnessing, which I believe brings more nuance into the picture. As she related to me, Al-Khatib began working as a freelance reporter, first for Arab channels, then for the UK's Channel 4 series Inside Aleppo in 2016. By that time, Russian forces were involved in the bombing. Channel 4 was seeking locals who could capture news stories for them, a common method of outsourcing when areas are inaccessible to their own correspondents. On her part, Al-Khatib could tell that the relationship was different from her previous experiences with news channels, which she said, usually talk to you once, take the story and that's it. Instead, a week later, she received an email from Channel 4 news editor, Ben Dapir, congratulating her on her report, which had gained 1 million views within 1 week. Some scenes in For Summer first appeared in Inside Aleppo, such as a miracle birth of a baby and a hazardous journey back to Aleppo from Turkey. In Inside Aleppo, the channel's own voiceover commentary is laid over the footage, as often happens when international media incorporate citizen videos, a suppression of their own soundtrack that reduces their effective power. However, removing Al-Khatib's voice, or not putting it there in the first place, was necessary at that time to protect her identity as she was still in Syria. Al-Khatib describes her collaboration with Channel 4 as one of mutual benefit. There was no other reporter, she said, that could deliver that material for them, and she was able to amplify her story on their platform. She already had her camera kit and they supplied her only with one lens. They didn't tell her what to film, but would ask her to follow a particular person or to know more about certain matters. And they gave her feedback, helping her to understand how to structure a story. In contrast to her experiences with other channels, they urged her not to take risks in order to film and made efforts to get her out of Aleppo by petitioning the UK Parliament and Red Crescent. What motivated Al-Khatib to turn her footage into a longer form narrative was realizing the power in her archive, or the footage that she had filmed over the years. While Inside Aleppo focused on the siege, she felt it was important for audiences to know the whole journey from the Syrian revolution when it all started in order to grasp why she and Hamza took the decisions they did. The genesis of For Summer began when she came to the UK for an award ceremony and revealed her archive's existence to Channel 4. Previously, they had not known what else she'd been filming since she only sent them news footage of besieged Aleppo. She and the news team jointly agreed the idea of producing a longer piece, initially 15 or 30 minutes long. However, when Al-Khatib showed them her material, it became clear that it would need to be of feature length. Al-Khatib was then introduced to her co-director, Edward Watts, with whom she then worked for 2 years. Both she and Watts were frequently told that there have been enough films about Syria, warning them not to expect much from For Summer. As Watts recollects, this is a quote, it was a travesty to hear that because it's so important for Wad and for all of us to witness this story. He said the film's whole creative approach was designed to counter that apathy. As mentioned, some commentators have criticized Watt's involvement as a white male British co-director. De La Rata interprets his role as a guardian rather than that of a peer or co-author, belonging to a type of neo-Orientalism, exploiting Syrian image makers who have access to the field, yet in the eyes of Western media industries are probably not powerful enough to produce a storytelling that would be considered compelling and marketable to global audiences. It is true that one reason why Channel 4 invited Watts was to translate Al-Khatib's story into a form that a Western audience could understand. Another was his commitment to Syria and his conviction that Western media reporting of the Syrian crisis had been obfuscated by Russian and Syrian regime war on terrorism propaganda. He believed that the public should know at its core that the conflict was about, he said to me, people like you and me fighting for democratic values, and we did nothing. Although having shared values doesn't rule out neo-Orientalist dynamics, just taking that viewpoint lacks nuance, as it doesn't consider the agency of all the parties involved, the terms on which the mediation in the field of witnessing occurs for them, and the constraints and possibilities. The working relationship between Al-Khatib and Watts was adversarial at times. Al-Khatib says that part of the great fight between them was turning the film into her personal story, which had not been her intention. Al-Khatib wanted it to represent collective struggle, while Watts argued that this was best expressed through her own story, which acted as a conduit to collective experience. The idea to structure the film as a letter to the baby daughter, Sama, came to them after the co-directors had already been working together for a year, so quite a long way into the process. Watts describes it as a kind of epiphany as they were immersed in Al-Khatib's footage, the story of Syria and the problem of how to tell her story. He believed it would help an audience to understand the day-to-day dilemmas that Wad was facing. He was saying to me, do you run to protect your baby or do you stay and fight for their future but risk losing everything? That extreme tension was important to convey to the audience, and the letter formats could transmit it. In his words, this approach freed them from the country and chronology of events, becoming much more about the human dilemma. It enabled them to structure the film as an engaging classical narrative in five acts with flashbacks. One, falling in love, two, being pregnant, three, the moment of ultimate choice in the siege, four, the catastrophe, and five, the aftermath. While the handheld camera weds us to Al-Khatib's perspective much of the time, the five acts are punctuated by drone footage revealing the city's large-scale destruction. These drone shots have attracted a lot of attention because of a perceived contradiction between their grand cinematic quality and the raw immediacy of war zone witnessing, which some critics believe excludes creative choices. But I argue in the book, this is a false dichotomy. According to De La Rata, and I quote, this drone view adds the spectacular to the film and makes it look like a proper mainstream documentary made for the consumption of Netflix and other similarly global palettes, end quote. However, Al-Khatib actually obtained her drone shots from a friend in Aleppo. Their activists were using drone technology to document the scale of devastation wrought by Russian-aided Syrian regime bombing of the city and uploading their footage to YouTube. So the drone shots are actually a crucial part of the film's witnessing. Watts saw these drone shots as offering audiences a breathing space, confirming one of De La Rata's reservations that it's there to kind of there to take you out of the intensity of what's of the conflict. However, both directors were concerned about overwhelming the audience, especially with graphic footage. Some of their discussions revolved around the witnessing value of graphic footage versus engaging the audience with the story. Even with the final version, the filmmakers were convinced, having repeatedly heard about Syria fatigue, that audiences would find it unbearable. They never expected its worldwide release and acclaim. Al-Khatib recalls sitting in the audience at the premiere at the South by Southwest Film Festival in Austin, Texas, waiting to see how many people would walk out. Instead, people came to her, moved, asking what they could do. And she told me, every time I heard this question from someone in the audience, I was just like, I did it. I gained what I wanted. So she really saw it as a vindication of her choices. It gave her a feeling opposite to her despondency about effecting change when she left Aleppo. from the Prix d'Ai at Cannes Film Festival to a BAFTA and Oscar nomination for Best Documentary, For Sama's profile has been raised by multiple awards, attracting more viewers who perhaps otherwise would not watch a documentary on Syria. For Della Retta, For Sama's emphasis on motherhood erases the political context of the Syrian revolution, ensuring that we see Al-Khatib as an individual, but not the wider struggle. Her critique highlights just how highly charged this territory is when few Syrian films galvanize such attention and many witnesses struggle to get heard. It evokes the general pressures on Middle Eastern cinema to fit within Western models, which limits what filmmakers are allowed to say and how they say it. That said, I would argue that For Sama is a successful example of witnessing, harnessing the constraints into creative opportunities. Due to its narrative choices, it has moved many people around the world and made them want to act. As a result, Al-Khatib set up the campaign Action For Sama, which consists of small actions that audiences can take. Linked to this action campaign, the film is not just a harrowing vision that people can promptly forget once they've finished watching, since it encourages them to do something practical, from sharing what they've witnessed on social media, to donating to humanitarian workers, asking the MP to watch the film, uploading their own creative response, and organizing community screenings. When the film screened at Cannes, Al-Khatib Watts and Hamza Al-Khatib held the sign, "Stop bombing hospitals." At Q&As for the film's 2019 theatrical release, the trio emphasized that what you're seeing in the film is still happening now in rebel-held Idlib, where the Syrian regime, aided by the Russian military, continued targeting hospitals. This year, Al-Khatib has used the film as a platform to condemn Russia's attacks on hospitals in Ukraine, which resemble its tactics in Syria. Ultimately, the film is a tool and opportunity in this ongoing struggle to keep the story being told day by day. So not only the story, but also the issues, the wider issues that it raises. So in this talk and in the book generally, I've attempted to deepen and complicate the existing picture of cinematic freedom of expression in the Middle East, the world's so-called crisis hotspot, with a shift of focus onto constraints as a generic term for limitations on free expression. I've brought into play a much wider range of obstacles that confront filmmakers and analyze some of the creative strategies that they're using to tackle them. This is essential for enhancing understanding of the conditions under which independent films from this region are produced and distributed. When filmmakers from the region produce content for international audiences, collaborating with Western producers and directors, it generates tensions and controversy about how their stories are shaped into a cinematic narrative for wider audiences. However, the example of For Sama reveals nuances in the power dynamics through the agencies of key people involved. Here, witnessing footage produced by a citizen journalist was powerfully restructured with the help of mediators, which propelled the film through festival, activist, and mainstream networks, presenting both challenges and opportunities. Okay, so I would like to end there and be grateful for your own insights and perspectives.
Thank you very much. This was a brilliant talk. I want to take the opportunity to thank you for actually selecting For Sama as an example for this keynote out of the array of films that your wonderful book covers, because it really highlights elements of bringing content from the Middle East to the UK audience and the negotiation collaboration of the filmmakers to bring it. I think, thank you so much. This was brilliant. I'm sure our wonderful audiences are eager to ask questions, please do. If you have a question, you can raise your hand and unmute yourself and ask your question. Or if you feel it's more comfortable, you can put your questions in the chat and I'll pass them on. And please feel free at this stage, if you would like, basically turn your cameras on that we can have a conversation among ourselves.
Maryam, I think Stephanie's got a...
Oh, yes, please. Right. Yes, thank you. I just changed my view. I was just adjusting. Thank you, Stephanie, please.
Hi, everyone. I'm so happy to be part of this and to hear Shohini talk about her new book. I'm so keen to read it. I told her before in an email, I can't wait to read it. I don't really have a question or anything. I just wanted to hear what you thought, because you highlighted something about the campaign that WIDE organized after the film had its sort of general release and was seen by the main to keep us thinking about the conflict. I can't remember her name, the woman who made Freedom Fields.
Mm-hmm. Nasiha Aribi.
Nasiha Aribi. Didn't she lead a campaign as well after her film and sort of made efforts to keep the story alive and give it an afterlife as well? I don't know if you know more about this and if you could tell us a little bit about it.
That's right. The women, so there was a campaign that she launched together with the women. So the film Freedom Fields, for those who haven't seen it, is a documentary about Libyan women's football team. And it follows them through the course of the Libyan civil war, when they were trying to just get a game of foot, just a practice football, and to compete in an international tournament, but that was scuppered by the civil war. And it explores their ways of getting around those obstacles, and they ended up training privately. And they did eventually get to an international tournament, but they didn't do that well, but they kind of recovered that through founding their own NGO, which is to empower girls and women through playing sport. And absolutely, the film plays an important role in sort of drawing attention to that campaign and drawing attention. And that's something that's a live, ongoing issue. So it's not just that the film has its own journey, theatrical release and other platforms. It has real impacts in people's lives. And that actually also affected the ethical issues around the film, because it was really important for the film to be seen in Libya as well as abroad. And that made Nasiha Aribi think about certain choices that she made so that the film could be seen within the country to the people that it's about, as well as to international audiences abroad. But absolutely, this idea of using the film as a tool and an opportunity once you've made it to have an afterlife, I think that's really key, especially for these films that use witnessing as a creative strategy.
And I also wondered if you knew more about, I know this is the case for Sama. I think there is also an educational element now linked to the documentary, where if the film is shown again in schools, perhaps in the UK, then teachers get sort of an educational pack or an information pack with the film in order to be able to teach it with the right sort of terminology, knowledge on the specificities of the film. Is this, in your view, is this part of that sort of afterlife that films that are perhaps part of a bigger campaign, of a bigger story?
Mm-hmm.
Because of course, when we think of documentaries, especially when they come from the Middle East, very often they are seen, you know, here as educational tools,
mm-hmm.
Not only when they're on TV, but also, mm-hmm. you know, in their afterlives. And I wondered if both, if you know whether both films have those elements to their afterlife, I suppose, that they are screened in schools and that they have those educational packs that you can download as a teacher.
Mm-hmm. I'm not aware of that personally, okay. But I wouldn't be surprised. And it would be interesting to see those educational packs and how they're presenting the film and the region, what they're explaining. And maybe we're highlighting these issues in particular because we're talking about activist films.
Yeah.
And Freedom Fields is an activist film of sorts, as well as For Zama. Yeah. But that isn't to say that all films from the Middle East are activists, but in, as you were suggesting, they do have an educational element when they cross borders.
Yeah. Suddenly they become this sort of source of knowledge.
Yes. Yeah.
To educate us in the West.
Yes. Yes. And that's because of the stereotypes that fill the mainstream media about the region, people, but it also can become a pressure on the filmmakers to create films that explain, that's a pressure that Nezihah Aribi herself experienced.
Yeah.
And the film Freedom Fields in an earlier version had title cards. And that was taken out, and the thinking behind that was partly because it wanted to present the situation from the ground, from the women who are undergoing it, where they didn't necessarily have that overview, even though they were living it. So there's this great line in the film, even if it's an explosion, tell me it's fireworks. The kind of, you know, so it's like we don't, you'll be kind of, even if you're in the conflict, you'll be kind of looking on Facebook, scrolling through Facebook or social media to find out what's going on, kind of just outside your, just in the same city that you're living in. So this kind of perspective of not knowing, I think, is part of the experience that she wanted to capture, and the film star really reflects that in sort of kind of chaotic, haptic style in which it's filmed.
Huh.
Yeah, so I think there should be a sort of, you know, it is a kind of constraint on free expression to expect that constant, you have to be explanatory, comprehensive, kind of that kind of take the audience through the situation in the country, provide a window for audiences that might not be familiar with it.
Thanks.
Perfect. Thank you very much for the question and the answer. I think we have two hands up. Can I go first to Shema, please? Please.
Hi. Hi, everyone. It's great to see everyone. I wanted to ask you, there's a couple of things there. Now, you were talking about so I'm a programmer, but I'm also a producer. So my question's coming from there. I have many times had to show films here, not had to, but wanted to show films here that I know I can't be seen where they were made. So for example, Nezihah's film is one of them. We couldn't acquire it for TV, for example, because we would have had to geoblock Libya, which is not something we can do, and so on. And also, but having screened certain films in cinemas here that wouldn't be seen in Egypt, it almost feels like, or wherever, you know, it seems like it's even more important to show these films here. But I always have this kind of idea that I'm not comfortable with. It's a shame, let's say, that the people that this film is made for and about can't see the film where they are. So there is that going on, right? But then we also have these kinds of sort of like this dichotomy between the filmmakers who want to make a film so that it can be seen where they are, which means that they have to forego certain points and certain scenes, certain conversations, do we want to say self-censorship of a certain type? Yeah. But then there's also, we will get equally uncomfortable when we have this sort of for Sema situation where there is some kind of cinematic language that is being translated so that we can see these films in the West and understand what's going on and not be frightened by the intensity and all of that stuff. So where do we negotiate the in-between? How do we actually convey what we want to say in the hard truth that exists, mm-hmm. while being able to communicate kind of, or encourage or whatever it is, markets, which is going to be a whole other section later, but like, how do we do that? How do we, where is the sweet spot in between these two?
Mm-hmm.
Is there one? are we hanging forever?
Yeah, Shema. So there are some examples where filmmakers have made several versions of the same film for different audiences. And one of them was Queens of Syria, which you screened at the BBC Arabic Festival. And there's a sort of BBC Arabic version. There's a festival version, and then there's another version, you know, and all the, they're all sort of tailored to a specific audience. And that's related to kind of political sensitivities, but also sensitivities around gender. So there was a scene at the end of that film, Queens of Syria, is about a group of Syrian refugee women in Jordan who put on a production of Euripides' play and Trojan Women. And there was gender censorship as well as political censorship in the choices that were made. A scene where a woman who was participating in the play blows a kiss at the end, and that was seen as not acceptable womanly behavior, or especially for a married Arab woman. And that was edited out of the version that was screened in the region, but it was kept in the sort of international film festival version. So there are ways that, you know, strategies, practical strategies that filmmakers have adopted of creating different versions. And Naziha Aribi organized private screenings of freedom fields in Libya. So that was kind of by, you know, having a small audience. It wasn't a general release, but it enabled a small section of the audience to see the film within Libya. But even that entailed certain choices that she had to make in order for it to be screened, even in that form. So yeah, there are big tensions, as you say, between you know, the sort of these very detailed decisions about what's left in the film for various reasons, ethical reasons sometimes, because it's because the participants are at risk, because the distribution of a film, international, national distribution, the afterlife of film carries further risks, and a film can become more dangerous over time because the situation in the outside world is evolving, and the protagonists within the film, if it's a documentary, their life situation is evolving at the same time. Maybe others have a solution to this, but that's, I'm just offering those as two examples. And Naziha Aribi also used humour, sort of humour is something that has the ability to be understood by certain audiences but not others, and go over the heads of certain sections of the audience. So she used that as a way of including certain things that she, you know, things that she left within the edit of the final film. So there's a kind of dual language going on, sort of targeting different sections of the audience.
Thank you so much. I think this is actually one, I've taken a note of it. This would be a nice kind of point of discussion to bring back to the round table as well. And thank you so much, Shohini, to kind of bring the practice that you've observed from different filmmakers across the region. Yael, you had your hand up. Do you want?
Yes, but maybe let's go for Rebecca. We've got 5 minutes.
Okay, perfect. So Rebecca, please.
Oh, thank you both so much. Thank you, and thank you, Shohini. It's so nice to see you again and be inspired by your research again. I was really sort of interested in the point that you were making sort of at the beginning of your talk, when you were saying that Middle Eastern women are having to sort of explain their part of the world while also negotiating Western stereotypes and sort of conforming to Hollywood narratives and sort of balancing those two things. And so I was really interested in sort of, and you talked a little bit about it in your talk, but the sort of formal choices that filmmakers were having to make in order to balance those things. So in order to conform to Hollywood narratives and Western stereotypes while also being true to themselves, I guess, if that makes sense. Mm.
So what would you like me to address? Just the kind of the balancing act, having to do that.
Mm. Yeah, the balancing act, and I guess how that sort of appears formally in the formal choices that the filmmakers are making.
Yeah. So if I could take a specific example, in the case of Freedom Fields, Naziha Aribi decided not to go for the kind of explaining that the whole of the Libyan civil war and what's been going on in Libya and the kind of didactic title cards. And that enabled her to let the film sort of breathe and be what it's really about, she said. But at the same time, it had a cost in that it made the film less commercially viable to some of the parties that they were talking to during the process. And it had a very, very long lead time, took many, many years to make, and in the course of that time the funding dried up, so this was really crucial. So it kind of, the film sort of was at risk of not being made at all. So deciding to go the other way can have these financial implications, but I guess it's, I think, kind of weighing up kind of what's really important in terms of priorities. And I think for her it was to do with security was one of the priorities, that she wanted to continue making films in Libya. The women wanted to obviously continue their lives there. So that had to be a priority, not sort of kowtow to certain expectations of how you're going to give a window into Arab Muslim women's lives, for example. So I think that in terms of that balancing act, it's often if you have that independence that she managed to have, to be able to set out clearly what the priorities are, but that isn't always available to filmmakers. And sometimes I think filmmakers do make certain compromises, but instead of just seeing it as a compromise, I mean, I hope I made this clear with my approach to For Summer, that it's also about harnessing the constraints to kind of take advantage of that platform that you're being offered to do what you want to do. And I think that that's what Wad al-Khatib was doing. And so she's an agent in this process and is pursuing her goals through that, you know, through this kind of field of witnessing where there are all these competing agents and asymmetric power relations. So absolutely, I think it's about, it's not just about kind of resisting, it's also about, okay, making pragmatic and creative solutions to the situation that's before them, harnessing the constraints to do what you can't do, which is one of the filmmakers said to me, to come from Saudi Arabia. So it's not just pushing against the boundaries, but actively making use of what you can do within the restrictions.
Fantastic. If no one's objecting, can we go for one more question as well? I see Angela, you put a question in the chat. Do you want to ask it yourself, please?
Yeah, but I think that Yael was before me. So sorry.
It's okay. I'll comment very, very, very quickly, because it sort of relates to the previous point. I think talking about those compromises, that filmmakers make, also in terms of the formal, way of dressing the film. I was very stricken about what you were saying about Fall Summer, because it was almost about the, she wanted to be about her own personal story, the collective story, and then there was this sort of dressing it as a personal story and hanging it on the child as a metaphor, because it's seen as something that would be more universal story, that would be, and I think it was probably played a part in the success of the film. It's almost a mirror story of Five Broken Cameras, which I wrote about, and a few others, which would be, so, you know, that kind of Western, global, international arena where the films are shown, there's the assumption of what they can and cannot take, even from these very activist films. So I've always been quite troubled by that. Somehow I've got an innate sort of resistance to that notion that, you know, the bigger perspectives of these activist documentary can be told by the Europeans about the Middle East, but the stories that we hear from the Middle East need to come from the personal story. I think it's an double-edged sword. But I think it definitely contributed in both cases, I assume, to the sort of success of the film. That was exactly the formal sort of compromise that the filmmakers made in order to make it potentially more palatable. So there was, just to put that out there as well, as one of those sort of compromises. I don't know if a lot of people share my own sort of unrest with that, but that might just be me. Shima agrees with me. Good. Thanks. Angela, do you want to ask your question? Sorry.
I was wondering if in the analysis of the representation, the traditional representations of the Middle East, you have considered the intersection of Orientalist and patriarchal tropes.
Is that a question for me about whether I've considered?
I'm really curious, because I was just taking a look to the image of Forsama, and I think that there is something there. I mean, they intersect. Why? Probably it's just my sensation. I don't know. I wanted to have your opinion.
So you believe they intersect in what way in Forsama? Can you unpack that?
The woman was classically represented in a patriarchal way, so taking care of a baby, and also there was a strong emphasis on the negative aspect of war. So I'm telling that because I'm working on Yemen war, and I have seen Yemeni photographers literally moving the attention towards positive reactions to war. So, for example, there was a picture depicting women secretly gathering, because Yemen society is really patriarchal, chewing cat, which is a kind of plant which gives hallucinations. So it was a positive reaction to war. So in the same way, I mean, in just one shot, that photographer showed how patriarchal and Orientalist tropes were disassembled. First of all, because women, differently from the classical narrative, were represented as independent. So they reacted positively to the trauma war by dancing, singing, playing instruments, also enjoying. And at the same time, what I found really, really interesting was this positive tone of the representation, which somehow delayed the need of Western support to Yemen. So showing women enjoying and reacting positively to the trauma of war means simultaneously eliminating the need of Western institutions supporting Yemenis. So for this reason, I was comparing the representation of the woman in the film and some really, really anti-patriarchal representation of women in Yemen. This reason I was thinking about how the two tropes intersect.
Yeah, I understand where you're coming from with that analysis. And yes, there's a long history of the intersectionality of patriarchal and oriental tropes, not least because the woman is the symbol, the national symbol, the symbol of sensuality and all the sort of the classic orientalist tropes. And there's so much focus on oppressed women in oriental stereotyping, and a belief, misguided belief, that Arab and Muslim society is the source of women's troubles, which is not entirely true. And this was something that came out in several of my interviews with filmmakers. For example, when Wad al-Khatib came to the UK for the first time, it was for an award ceremony, television award ceremony, where she'd been given the prize for the best camera operator. And she was shocked to learn that it was the first time that a woman had been given that prize. And her reaction was like, oh, you know, I thought it was our community, but it's like a much bigger struggle. So I think in my book, I do acknowledge that these are tropes that intersect, but I also want to sort of stand back and look at how this is a systemic thing, and it's not just to do with Arab Muslim societies. I suppose that's a kind of breaking of the orientalist stereotype, so I was keen to do that in the way that I talked about film practice. And the way that I talk about the films is much more to do with the decisions, the production, the material circumstances that the filmmakers face, and the reading of the film is very much sort of geared towards that, sort of trying to see things from their perspective rather than offering a sort of textual analysis of the films. Okay, thank you for the question, and thanks everyone for questions today.
Yeah, thank you so much. I just wanted to kind of again thank Shohini for kind of setting again this context for us. This whole idea of something that in your talk you focused by bringing for Samoa, this idea that these filmmakers are not just making a film from within the context that they're making the films, but also kind of considering the audiences beyond the borders of the countries that they're living. Quite like the quote you put in from Moni Hariri, saying that that's what they want, like, you know, the Western audience wants to kind of focus on the censorship and the issues that we are facing. I wish it would break away from it. But at the same time, going and looking at the production process of For Samoa, besides the fact that how the raw materials were selected and how it was then put together as a narrative into that feature length, it's so interesting to kind of come into different points of production to kind of see what sort of considerations are taken on board. I really invite everybody to read Shohini's book, because this is something that I think the scholarship in film, especially films from the region, a lot of the wonderful colleagues that are actually present here are trying to do, but this book is doing it very refreshingly, because you've actually spoken to all these filmmakers, and the space you've given to each of these filmmakers about reflecting on their practice is something that is very refreshing and very new. And in a way, your research really bridges like the practice research into kind of the kind of classical scholarship in film, and bringing them side by side, so that the interviews are not just sitting there as interviews, but they are actually telling us insightful negotiations and that they had to go through to find those solutions against the constraints that you've identified. I think it's fantastic. And again, I can't thank you more. Like the four Samo, I think, was a fantastic example to look at today. And I think we should all take a short break. Then we will all join back at 1:30 with the wonderful roundtable that to further these discussions and open it up from different perspectives, and that each of our wonderful panelists bring their own experiences, whether it's from the scholarship side, whether it's from a curatorial, from programming side to it. And thank you for everybody who's here. And again, thank you so much, Shohini, for this brilliant keynote. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
So, Maryam, should we leave the link open and people can join at 1:30?
Yes, I'll just stop the thing, and I have a little thing to share. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Will it be?